See, Königsberger. That was my name, Königsberger. It wasn't Kingberg. Familienstammbuch, family tree, in English. My name today is Arthur H. Kingberg. I had to choose that name before I became a U.S. citizen. They suggested to me, the name you have isn't going to go in the United States. I had a room I rented from a Jewish family in the Upper Manhattan. My room had a big window facing 165th Street. I could see everybody who was walking by there. I just happened to look out the window. I see this young lady walking by. Boy, she looks cute, chic. The way she walked, the way she was dressed in a coat, it was just cute. And she lived next door where my friend was living. So I asked her, Marion was her name. I said, do you know this girl? Oh, yes, she's a very good friend of mine. Her name is Ruth. I used to drive to work with my 41 Chevy Coupe. So one day, I couldn't take the car for some reason, and I had to take the subway. I go down the subway station at the platform, and I get there. I says, Marion, hi, Arthur. I says, hi. I says, Arthur, meet Ruth. I says, hi, Ruth. I took one look at her, bingo. I mean, bingo, it's like lightning struck. Blonde blue eyes, curly hair, gorgeous. And a figure. She was just gorgeous. I asked where she worked. I said, you know, Ruth, I go past your place of work every day with my car. You know, I could drop you off in the morning, not at night, not coming back, but in the morning I could drop you off. Let me know if you're interested. I'll take you to work in the morning, especially when it's bad weather. 3 or 4 days later, she said, okay, you can drop me off. Didn't say much at first. Then we talked phone back. She said, I'm a Holocaust survivor. You are? So am I. She says, where did you end up? She says, in England, with the Kinder transport. The Kinder transport? Yeah, I wound up in England, Kinder transport. And where did you wind up? I says, Ruth, it's a long story. I have an older sister who's 2 years older than I am. Her name is Marion. And I have an older brother whose name is Ernst Ludwig. My name is Helmut, spelled H-E-L-M-U-T-H. It's not very common in Germany. And I have a younger brother, his name is Alfred. My dad, my biological father, had a furniture business with his brother in Frankfurt, a big business. I attended 1 year kindergarten, and the following year, at age 7, I attended first grade elementary school, what you would call it. In 1930, Germany had a high rate of inflation. 50% unemployment was going on. There were soup kitchens all over the country. The people were starving, including us, with rationing. How many heads in a family? You got so many tickets. It was a terrible situation in Germany, very bad. And along comes Adolf Hitler, and he made speech after speech. And when he spoke, he became more and more aggressive and more anti-Jewish. He says, I'm going to fix things. Ich mache alles besser. That means I'm going to make things better. And so they listened to him. Something seriously happened with my parents and my dad. It disappeared. I don't know where he went. It just disappeared. Grandmother and mother put us in orphanages. There were no orphanages for girls in Germany, only boys. So they kept Marion, but they put me in an orphanage with other 30 children. Ernie and Fred, the older one, the younger one, they wound up in another orphanage, and all Jewish, incidentally. Both these orphanages were supported by philanthropists, Jewish philanthropists. Some kids had visitors on weekends, either family related, not many. Once a month, my grandmother, we called them Omi, a wonderful woman. She was a substitute mother for me. I found out that mother had a new acquaintance, a much younger man. So they had a boarding house business, which they managed or owned, I don't know. Meanwhile, we're in the orphanages. As Hitler came to power in 1936, he became the Chancellor, or they called him the Führer, Heil Hitler. You know, everything was Heil Hitler, Heil Hitler. You don't say hello anymore to anybody, it's Heil. The Hitlerism spread all over. He changed the German flag from black, white, red. He changed it to the swastika flag, all red with a white circle and a swastika. That was the new German flag as of 1936, when he became the Führer. Ich bin der Führer, you know, I am the Führer. Sieg Heil, all this baloney. So everybody had to wear a swastika. If you didn't, they already knew you're anti-Nazi, okay? And you had to be very careful. My mother, meanwhile, who still had my sister, and she now had that new acquaintance, whatever you want to call him, supposed to be my future stepfather. Not being part of the party, not being a member of the party, the Gestapo came looking for him like the rest of them. He and my mother and my sister had to escape from Germany overnight. The only place they could go at the time was Switzerland. They could come to Switzerland for 6 months. This is 1937. They're in Switzerland. 6 months. Time has come to an end. They had to get out. I don't know if people know about this, but Shanghai, China took in all kinds, thousands of refugees at the time. The way things were going on in the world, especially in Germany, a lot of escapees. You didn't need any documents. Chinese would take you in. The Shanghai Czech government was very liberal. He was the president at the time. And you could go to Shanghai for safe haven. That's where they went. We are in orphanages in Frankfurt. Don't know where they are, what's happening. No letters, no telegrams, no nothing. I never saw my sister again. They took her with them. But when they left Switzerland, they left her behind. Then Shanghai. The Japanese bombed Shanghai and China and invaded China. They had to get out. And the only country known to accept any kind of refugee, no matter what, was the Philippine Islands, with the last ship going out of China. The last ship going out of there. And we're at the orphanages while this is going on. The orphanage, there were five bedrooms, six boys to each room. He'd get up in the morning, get washed, get dressed like everybody else, and down for breakfast. We each had our own wash station in the orphanage. You had a sink and a tub for 30 kids. It was a large room. So you each had your own medicine chest, and your personal things, toothbrush, toothpaste, soaps, whatever, and get washed. And then you, they had you line up with a, she was not a nurse, she was just a lady attendance to look over us. Just, and she checked us out, if you're clean, she checked your ears. She does. And after that, we had breakfast, and then we got ready to go to school. We went to a Jewish school in downtown Frankfurt, and we had to walk half an hour if the weather was okay, weather permitting. If not, we had to take a streetcar. They gave us the money for the streetcar. We went to school, and then after school, we went home about 2:30, 3 o'clock. And we usually walked together with some other kids, small groups. You had your own personal friends, mostly the ones when you're in your own bedroom, the roommates. Coming home, we did our homework. We had a special room, like a library, with books and all, where the kids did their homework. The manager of the orphanage, he was the teacher. He went around and checked with the kids if they had any problems. Then we had done a supper at about 6 o'clock. To go for supper, you had to line up. All the kids had to line up and get there with a tray to get their food for dinner. This was a daily routine. So we had a shop down below, downstairs, like a workshop, and we had all kinds of tools, material to work with, which was great. And I was very interested right from the beginning on. I was looking to do things, and I fixed things at the orphanage, things that broke. I don't remember whatever broke. I glued it together or I screwed it together. But we had planers, we had hammers, we had screwdrivers, we had pliers, we had all kinds of tools for kids. And I was very active in that room, and I was known for that. If you want to know something, how to fix it, or get it fixed, go see Helmut. Once during the summertime, we had an outing for the kids. We made kites. Near the orphanage was a huge playground, grass. We took our kites there, and we had contests who got the highest with the kite. And it was great fun. We had kite flying maybe once a month. Oh, I learned, would you believe this? I learned hair cutting. I had these hand clippers and scissors and a comb, and I cut some of the kids' hair. Near the end, we couldn't go out anywhere, but I still was able to school unhurt or unharassed. There was a bunch of kids of us together walking, Jewish kids, going through a Nazi neighborhood, walking. They didn't touch us. So that was a good thing. The orphanage had a big playground in the back. As you can see in the picture, the concrete wall facing the street, but the rest of the playground was fencing, regular wire fencing. I said to the boss, to the management there, I says, you know, we have that playground in the back, it's nothing doing here in the wintertime. December, January, February, you know, nothing to do. I suggested to management, I said, why couldn't we make a skating ring out in the back? It's got a big place, flat. And I said, they looked at me and says, skating ring? Gee, that's a great idea. Helmut, that's a great idea. Let's do it. They agreed to it, and we fixed up the bag so there's no leakage. We filled it with water, and we had a skating rink. A skating rink. Unbelievable. So the orphanage supporters supplied the kids with skate shoes and skates. The whole bunch of them, 30 of them. And we skated. December, January, February, they had a ball. We had a great ball. I need to mention, our neighborhood, all around us, was all Nazis. 100% Nazis all around. It's the only Jewish group in the whole neighborhood. So while we're skating, after about 6 months or so, in December, the neighborhood kids came around in the back. They looked through the fence. Look, I'm skating, you know, there's can we come in? Can we come in? I said, sure. So we asked the boss, the company, orphanage, could the kids come in? Sure, if they're gonna come in, let them come in. So the kids asked their parents, the Nazi parents, can we go skating over with the Jewish kids? So go ahead. So the neighborhood Nazi kids came skating with us, a bunch of them. On weekends, on holidays, vacation time, they came skating. They had a whole bunch of them. They had a lot of good friends with the kids, the Nazi kids, with the Jewish kids, holding hands, skating. I had a couple of very good friends, Nazi kids. Heinrich and Wilhelm was one of the typical German name, Heinrich and Wilhelm, something. Anyway, they had a great time. The kids made a lot of friends. November 9th, 1938. That's just a few months after my bar mitzvah. They burned the temple. A beautiful, beautiful building in downtown Frankfurt. One very famous buildings. It was located what we call the Altstadt in Frankfurt. It's called the Old City, the old part of Frankfurt, very historic. That's where the temple was. Huge building, gorgeous. They burned it. The next day, the kids stopped coming. The kids stopped coming. You want to see broken hearts? Those kids were broken up. I'm talking to Nazi kids, us kids too, me too. We had good friends, good relationship. We played together at games on the ice. They stopped coming. 3 weeks later, after the kids stopped coming, one of their Nazi guys, one of the big guys, a tall, handsome guy, I never forget him, he came to the building. He wore his uniform, the Reichswehr, the military uniforms and a hair cap, but he didn't wear a swastika. Ich will den Helmut sprechen. He says, he wants to talk to Helmut. I was downstairs doing something. So I says, Helmut, komm rauf, da ist jemand hier zu suchen. He says, Helmut, come up, there's somebody looking for you. For me? No. So I came up, and I come up and I see this guy standing there, this Nazi. I said, uh-oh. What the heck does he want? What did I do? Are we going to take me away or something to the camp? I was shaking. I don't know what he was up to. But I saw he had that, he was carrying a thing. I was shaking. He saw me coming. I said, Mr. Helmut, are you Helmut? I said, yeah. Come on here. Come here. I was shaking like a leaf. I says, he says, beruhige dich. Relax, he said, relax. I'm not going to relax. I thought he was going to take me away. Oh, he says to me, come on here. I say it in English, but German is completely different. I have a surprise for you, said to me. A surprise for me? I didn't know what to say. He says, I got a a placard here. It means like a sign. I have a sign here. I want you to mount on the front door. He takes the cover off to find the thing. I say, I missed it, I couldn't. Without permission, entrance here is forbidden. It's not allowed. I couldn't believe what I was reading. Ohne Erlaubnis, Eintritt ist verboten, in German. He said, I want you to mount this on the front door. Without permission, no entrance permitted. A verboten, it's typical German. And on the bottom it said, call this number, Ruth is called. Call this number with the phone number, I guess. And his, some kind of a medal or something from his party, and a swastika on the bottom next to it, which means it's authoritatively. And I noticed the kids were all watching behind the windows, so what's going on behind the curtains. What's going on? They couldn't hear what was going on. I didn't know what to say. That meant your home is not going to be touched. That's what that meant. I saved the kids from taken away to the camp. That would happen. So I said to him, I was in tears. How can I thank you? How can I thank you? And he said, don't thank me, I thank you, he said. And he thanks me. Thank me for to allow our kids to skate for 2 years. That's what he said. So then he said, he put his hand on my shoulder. Ich danke dir, he said. You know what that was? It sounds like God had his hand on my shoulder. He did. He was watching. A Nazi and a Jewish kid. Ich danke dir. And he said, Auf Wiedersehen, bleib gesund und gut. Be well and well and healthy. And he left. After he left, I went inside with a sign. You should have seen the kids. They jumped all over me. I mean, they jumped all over me like at a baseball game. I was now 15 years old. Time to get out. Helmut, your Omi is here. He wants to see you. We had a little, what they call a private room in the building. If somebody had a visitor, they had a private room. We went to the Privatzimmer. She reaches in her purse and she shows me, I got a telegram. Okay, telegram from who? From Mutti, from my mother. What? After 8 years? I got a telegram from Mutti. Yeah, from where? From Manila, the Philippines. The what? Manila, the Philippines? Islands? Where in the world is that? She says, I think it's down by the China someplace. The Philippines. She wants me to arrange for you to come to the Philippines. I missed the Cotton Dynamite. It took a couple of months for her to get all the papers and the documents And we finally got out what they call a Kinderausweis. This is like a child certificate exit paper from Germany, like a little junior passport. Ernie was 16, I was 15. Then Freddie was 11. You were allowed to take one crate of whatever you want to put in personal belongings. She arranged that. She had to get tickets for the train from Germany to Switzerland. From Switzerland, we had to go to Italy, to Genoa. She bought the train tickets, paid for it. She boarded us in second class on an ocean liner from Genoa, Italy, to Manila, the Philippines. She says she would come with a taxi to pick us up, to pick me up, then the other two brothers. And in those days, if you ordered a taxi in Germany in 1939, you didn't get a car. You get a horse and buggy. Like the ones, if you've been to the Amish country, those coaches, that's the kind, was a taxi with two lanterns on it. And that's, she picked us up. So when we got to the Frankfurter Hauptbahnhof, this is the main station in Frankfurt, and then it was time to say, we weren't going to say Auf Wiedersehen. You know what that means? You couldn't say Auf Wiedersehen because you won't see her again. This was my worst heartbreak ever, because she looked after us for 8 years while we were in the orphanage. She used to come see us. And then I would say goodbye. The three of us with suitcases, this grandma, Umi, hugging us. I didn't know what to say. Thank you wasn't mean anything. You couldn't thank her enough for what she had done for us in place of my mother. That's the only love we ever got. I got my biggest shock when we came to the border of Germany and Switzerland. It's called the Brenner Pass. They don't speak German. German trains are fire coal, the steam engine. The Swiss trains are electric. The German border police comes on the train. This was at night. What's in euer Papier? I mean, where are your documents? So I showed him our documents. Where's Helmut? Das bin ich. And who's Helmut? Me. There's Ernst and Fred. Okay. And then you have Gepäck. I mean, you got luggage? I said, yeah. I see you also got a big crate. Yeah, that's for mother. And I watched him. He looks, he's a German border police bastard. You should have seen him in his uniform, bastard, the swastika. He looked at it, he didn't say anything. I got scared. And I says, the inventory is on the back, on the crate outside. He looked at it and says, and he looked at this, he made comparison. Yeah, das stimmt. Then he said, das geht nicht mit. This does not go. What do you mean it doesn't go? He says, shut up, he said. Sag ruhig, das geht nicht, das confiscated. He kept the document. And he said, jetzt raus. Now get out, he said, jetzt raus. Just like that, get out. So we get out, there's a lot of people, and he comes out with us because we are unguarded. He took us to where the other train is coming. There were a lot of people there. He pushed them aside so we can get by. On the platform, you know. And the train wasn't there yet. The Swiss train, usually they're waiting. So he said that, Der Zug hat eine Verspätung. The train is late, he said. So he went past the people, us behind him, to look if the train was coming, because you can't hear him, it's electric. So he went to the platform, and he went to look if the train was coming, and he could, you know, just couldn't hear it. You know what happened? A miracle happened. He fell on the track. He fell on the track, the train went over him, killed him. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. God struck. He struck. But he had the document for the kid. So I told the guy in charge of Capek on a baggage car, we have a crate on the deck. So he went and looked. What's the name? Königsberger. So he went and looked, yeah, Königsberger, nach Genua. So we got the crate. We got the crate. Okay, we get on the train. This is at night. I had all the documents. We get to Genoa, everything Italian, no German. What does it mean? Hasta pazore, contate, conciamonero. Mamma mia, help me. So in the back, there's a man standing, going like this, at the arrival gate at the shipping dock. He was waving to us. He was the steward for our cabin. Italiano, but he spoke some German. He took care of us, even got us some pastry sometimes, you know, he smuggled it in. Very nice fellow. But he spoke a little German, that was it. But it was the end of German. 21 days unescorted. We went through the Suez Canal. The cabin guy took us on a land tour. He took us for a ride around town and showed us the town. We didn't know what the heck we're looking at. Strange looking world. Can't you imagine? You've never seen anything like it. And they wore these funny hats with a thing on top. I remember that. And we saw camels walking around. Camels! Not horses, camels. But for us kids, it's like a storybook. Okay, we got back aboard the ship, and then we went through the Suez Canal. On one side, you saw columns of camels walking, with, of course, people were riding on them. On the other side, there was a highway. There were cars going up and down. You can imagine the Suez Canal, you see cars here and camels here. Down through Eden, we didn't get off in Eden. And we went down to, we passed Ceylon, Colombo, Ceylon, the tea country. We didn't stop there. We stopped in Bombay, India. Hot as hell. It was hot in Bombay. God, we stopped there for just a few hours and we took off again. And the next stop was Manila. And there she was. Mother was waiting for us at the pier in Manila as we arrived. I could hardly recognize her. So she told us, we're not going to stay in Manila, we're going to Mindanao. What? We're going to Mindanao? I thought we were going to go to school here in Manila. I only had 8th grade. Nein, das machen wir nicht. I mean, we don't do that here. We're going to Mindanao, where they had a farm. So she said, we're going to get an inter-island ferry from Manila to Davao City in the capital of Mindanao. It's an 8-day journey. The farm that we saw, so-called farm, was nothing but bamboo growth, bamboo shoot growth. all over the place. Bamboo, and rattan. He put us to work to cut down the bamboo and burn it so he could clear the land to plant things. That's what we did. But they had no choice. They had to escape from China, the Japanese invasion of China. The only place they could go was the Philippines. And the only thing they could do, the Philippines, they were given the land, and you can do whatever you want with it, and that was it. And they get us from Germany into the jungle. 2 years. 2 years on Mindanao. Trying to acclimatize to the Philippine tropics, how we lived. Steps going up to the hut, not stairs, steps you had to hold on. The prevailing illness for foreigners is malaria. We had to get mosquito nets and a rattan 100 feet long around the bikes and the wild plants, poison grass. I still have marks on my legs from the poison grass. We had no running water. It was a creek. That was our water supply. So to get water, we had to build a platform by the edge of the creek where we could fetch the water in a bucket and bring it to the house. The way we had to cook, open fire with a grill built on rocks. We got some sheet metal and we constructed a low shed. And when it rained, the water ran down and we had a 6-inch diameter bamboo, which we cut in half. And the water was collected by the bamboo into a container. And that became our means of drinking water. It was pure and screened through filtration. So it was safe. We're still alive. We also built a chicken coop with bamboo and rattan, and we had a bunch of chickens. We also got eggs. So one night, a snake got in, a big constrictor boa, and got a hold of one of the chickens. I was always up front somehow. Ernie, my older brother, wasn't quite as aggressive as I was. And Freddie was too young. My stepfather came out and he said, "I'll hold the light for you and I'll give you this hatchet." I said, "Okay." He shone the light on her and she stopped. She stopped dead. I took that big, it's a heavy machete. It's not like the ones you carry. This is the ones that's like an axe. In one shot. And I cut the head off. We had to have means of transportation to go to the highway where the Chinese merchants were, the shopping area. We went from the interior of the jungle where the farm was. We had to go out and get things, foodstuffs, canned goods, whatever we needed we could buy. We still had pesos we could use to pay for things. We acquired an Indian bull. It has a hump in the back and with horns. I designed a saddle for the bull, made of rattan, with ropes on it, and I was the designated driver. I rode the bull. Once a week, I think, I went out to the highway to buy stuff. It was a 2.5-hour journey. There was no other way. No roads, only a trail. Some you had the machete and sometimes clear the trail. We planted with some peanuts, some corn, and of course we planted also apica seedlings. The reason they were growing hemp, by experience from other farmers there, a good many Americans, they had hemp farms on Mindanao, but they grew hemp. It's converted into rope. That's how they got the name Manila rope. And this is a lot of these Americans. They've lived in Mindanao for years. We grew Manila ham and other veggies, 1939 to 1941. Now I'm 17. The Americans started leaving the Philippines. They all left because they got word that the Japanese are going to invade the Philippines. So they all went home. New York, San Francisco, God knows where they went. Wisconsin, Ohio, don't know. The Americans left everything behind, except their personal stuff, and they left. And remember that one couple I was friendly with has said, if you ever come to the States, be sure to stop in and see us. Yeah, lots of luck. December 7, 1941, Pearl Harbor, Kapow. The Japanese bombed the Philippines ruthlessly. They bombed Leyte, which is the least populated island, but they flattened Luzon, everything around Manila was kaput. They bombed very little of Mindanao. We had to get out. We decided to go to Samal Island, a small island, probably 100 miles long, maybe 75 miles wide. But we made sure there was water running. So we scanned the southern coast of Mindanao, and we found a rowboat, not a bunker, like a native boat. The paddles were still on it. It was deserted, and it was beached. We took that. And we loaded all our stuff, whatever we had, on the boat, whatever we could take. They took it to Samar Island. The coastal area in Samar Island was deserted. They were afraid of the Japanese coming in. But we told them, don't worry. We made the selection, and I gave them the reason in their own language. I spoke pretty well at the point. From Mindanao, I learned. So they helped us, the natives on Mindanao, on Samar Island, helped us to find a shack. They brought us foodstuffs to get us started. They got the bananas, cassava, that's the potato. They brought us eggs and chicken. And they even had milk from the buffalo. It was good. We got two shacks, one for the parents and for the three of us another shack. I asked my mother, did you ever buy coconut oil? There's so many coconuts here. She said, oh yeah, it's hard to get, it's very expensive. I said to them, I'm gonna take a couple of coconuts and cook them. We grind them up, pulverize them, whatever. We had to pulverize them. I don't know how to open them. I put the coconut in a pot and cooked it on a slow fire. The coconut completely disappeared and melted down, and it was a liquid. So I took it off and I let it cool down and I tried to taste it. Oh boy, that's oily. Guess what? It was oil. Coconut oil. I poured off the oil from the pot and there was a residue on the bottom. So after it cooled down, I poked around with that hard stuff. Was a brownish looking color. And I tasted it. Wow, was it sweet. That's sugar. We started making coconut oil and sugar. We got coconuts by the cartful. We got a bull cart from the locals. They lent it to us. We went and collected coconuts day in and day out. It took 6 bull carts full of coconuts to make one procedure. We were able to get a container made of galvanized steel. So I acquired one of these big pans. We mounted it on rocks so I could fire under it. The coconut husk is flammable, burnable. And the coconut shell, the empty shells that we ground, is good for fuel. We were in production. To carry this further, we used a pan like that and mounted it on another station with rocks, and we filled it with seawater. We cooked the water and we got salt. We survived. All the 3 commodities were used for bartering. And some of it was smuggled to the main island, Mindanao, at night, because they couldn't get it on Mindanao. They smuggled it in exchange for other goods. They brought us stuff from Mindanao during the Japanese occupation. We made a list what we would like, and let's see what they could add. It was on an exchange basis. We're on Samal Island for 3 years, surviving. We saw the Japanese patrols go by, the high-speed boats going by, but they wouldn't even look at Samal. I knew that. But we were safe. We were safe there. Near the end of the 3rd year, I said, I'm not staying here. The Marines are invading. They're coming to Mindanao. I'm going to go and see if I can meet with them. I left with another lady friend of mine. We paddled a day and a half to meet up with the invading Americans in northern Mindanao. So we met up with the first GIs. I went like this. He said, from a distance, he saw me coming. He says, a white man, put your hands down. He said, put your hands down, he said. I said, come here. So I went and talked to him. I says, he wanted to know, where are you from? Where are you from? So I told him, the Holocaust survivor, and my parents are on the island. I says, I hope they don't bomb him. You know, there's a war going on. So he got on the signal corps phone or whatever, and he called headquarters. Samal Island, off limits. Samal Island, off limits. I heard him say it. Off limits. He put the word out to make sure they're safe. Made sure they didn't get hit accidentally. There's a war going on. When they got me to headquarters for the 24th Infantry Division, I was talking to that Filipino. I says, you're okay to be here. Don't worry about a thing. They'll take care of you. So they spotted me as I was talking to my companion, my friend there. Says, oh, you speak the lingo. I says, yeah, to some degree. He says, we can use you. They asked me, would I be willing to scout together with the colonel to get behind the Japanese lines and see if you can locate their defenses? I said, okay, sure, of course. I would volunteer to do this for the United States. They put the colonel and me together. They put us on a PT boat off the coast of Mindanao. They dropped us overnight. We had to swim in with all our equipment, life jackets and the rest. A 3.5 hour swim. 3.5 hours from where they dropped us off to the coral reefs. He said, goodbye. You're on your own. When we got there, there was no beach whatsoever, all coral reefs. So we had to look for some kind of a cavity where we just get in there and we could climb up to the top of the land. And always on the lookout in case there were Japanese patrols. We start crawling to look for the Japanese installations. Before we know it, we found some. We found a whole bunch of them. They were so heavily camouflaged, you couldn't see them. You had to crawl up to them almost. We were so close, you could almost hear them talk. So we didn't talk, we went by sign only. Says, we crawled around and looked for the defense installations. We found at least, I don't know how many we found, but he marked them on the map, the colonel. He marked all those places we detected. And the big prize was, he found the 16-inch gun installations, 3 of them. Those 16-inch guns would have been a disaster. After 2.5 days or so, they want us to get out. They says, we give you 12 hours to come back. We crawled back, and then we walked at least we must have walked for a day to meet back up with the GIs. They took us back to the headquarters in the Jeep. The next day, you should have seen the bombardment that opened up on them. They wiped them out. The Japanese were wiped out, and they came out surrendered. Japanese surrendered. That was the end of the war in the Philippines. It ended the war in the Philippines because Mindanao was the last stronghold. They didn't say to me, okay, you can come to the States now for what you did or whatever. No. That's the mystery I could never figure out. I could never figure out why I couldn't come to the U.S. based on what I've done. I knew my relatives lived in New York City. Division headquarters put me in touch with the Red Cross to help me to find my relatives in New York. And believe it or not, they did. They found them. And once they found them, they put me together with them that they should issue a visa for me to immigrate to the U.S. That took some time. It exactly took 2 years. While I was waiting, they gave me a position on one of the supply ships. The name of the ship was Sultan, Daniel Sultan. I worked with the chief engineer's office for 2 years. We went all around the Pacific supplying the troops from Korea, Guam, Saipan, Yokohama, until I got clearance to come to the U.S. I arrived in San Francisco September 21st, 47. We got to Mindanao in 1939. I got acquainted with a couple of American families there. They have a hemp farm. They all had hemp farms. I recall they said to me, Arthur, if you ever come to the United States on the West Coast, be sure to stop and see us. Come see us. I says, okay, thanks, I appreciate it. I rang the bell. Mary and Bill Goon, nice folks. They opened the door. She screamed, Mary screamed. I said, Arthur, you know, huh? She almost collapsed. How in the world did you get here? And the first thing I did, I started looking for work. I came penniless. The third or fourth job was with a company called General Electric. They had a problem with the electric blankets. They had wire throughout, and they short-circuited and they burned. They saw what I was doing. You seem to get a good handle on this thing. We have three more guys we could hire, and you could supervise them. My pay almost doubled. That's what I needed, because I wanted to get to New York. I made enough money. I bought a used car, a 41 Chevy coupe, a two-seater car. I resigned. I paid for the car, cash. And I drove it from San Francisco to New York in 5 days. Remember the old famous Route 66 from west to Chicago, and then and from Chicago Route 40 to New York. I remember that. And I made it. I made it. Once I got to New York, I went job hopping from one job to another. Before a year was out, I was doing supervisory work. And this was in the maintenance area of manufacturing. People are having problems with machinery, equipment breaking down. They hired me and I solved the problems. I took a home study course, Gumper's Trade School. I took a course in maintenance so I could learn more of the terminology that's used when you're describing particular problems in manufacturing or naming of products or naming of parts or material. There was a job, they were looking for a plant engineer, somebody to take care of all the mechanical problems in the factory. Mirror manufacturer, mirrors, you know mirrors? Mirrors manufacturer, what the heck do I know about mirrors? I said to myself, it doesn't matter. It's mechanical, I think I can work it. You had to send in a resume. So I went to see a professional. They write resumes for you. He says, Arthur, whatever you do, your resume shouldn't be more than one page. Because they got stacks of resumes. They wouldn't look at them. If it's more than a page, you don't have a chance. I said, okay. So I tried that with a couple of companies. One page, no response. I said, the heck with it. The next one, I did it my way. I wrote a resume way from the beginning, including the Holocaust. I told the whole story, my experience, what I've experienced since coming to the United States. It was a 2.5 page resume. Sealed and mailed it in. 3 or 4 days later, I get a phone call. That's how we started. I dropped it off. So I took her a few times and I said, could I ask you for a date? She said, I'm engaged. I said, you're what? You're engaged? Oh my God. I guess that's the end of the story. You're engaged. I says, so when you're getting married, we haven't set a date yet. We're working on it. I says, how long you been going? Steady. She gave me, I forgot what time it was, how much time. She didn't sound very enthusiastic about it. I could tell. I said, you're engaged. So I had to figure out I was really going to go after her. She was the one. She was the one. No question about it. I said, how about a double date? You know what's a double date, don't you? Oh, sure. How about a double date on a Saturday night? We can go up. There's a nice nightclub up the line here. They serve dinner and they have a band. They have a dance floor. So ask your fiancé if he wants to be interested. So a week later, she came back and says, okay, he liked the idea. Oh, I said, my goodness. Sure enough, I got myself another gal, to go for the double date on a Saturday night and then nightclub up the line. And I couldn't take the car. He had a car. It could take 4 people. So we went in his car, and 4 of us. I remember the name of the place. Bill Reber's was well known for young folks. They had music, they had a band, they had a dance floor, and they served dinner, and they served wine. Perfect. We went on that Saturday night date. Ruth sat across, and he sat next to her, and I sat with my girl over here. She was sitting across from me. So we all get in there, we start talking, and Ruth didn't say too much. That was strange, you know. So after a while, we had dinner, and we had a couple of drinks and wine. I took my girl on a dance floor, and we danced. After about 2 or 3 dances, how about switching partners, I asked him. He said, okay, just like that, okay. So I took her on a dance floor, and I showed her a couple of dances. I said, look, just hang on, I'll take you on the floor. I took her to the far end of the dance floor. I took her to the far end and I said, are you really gonna marry this guy? She was shaking. Poor thing, she was shaking. And she grabbed me and says, She didn't answer. And we danced. I was a good dancer too. Don't ask me how, but I knew how to dance. We came back to the table and we kept talking. She didn't say much. And so we're sitting on the table and under this was a big table. Under the table, I was playing footsie with her foot. She was shaking. He said, are you all right? He asked her, are you all right? She said, oh yeah, She wasn't very forthcoming. I stopped. Okay, I fixed that. So it was a very nice evening. We had dinner, we left, we all went home, and I kept driving her to work. You know, I had a shift car. You still had a stick shift. And one day, as I was shifting, she put her hand on my hand. I says, "Uh-oh, that's it. That's it." She was engaged. She's engaged. She puts her hand on my hand. That's the end of the engagement. I said, 3 weeks later, I kept taking her to work. She says, "I broke up my engagement. I broke up my engagement." Yes, you did? No kidding. Well, that was the cake. That was the cake. She broke up her engagement and I started dating her. What a dating that was. We got engaged. We went steady for 9 months. We got married. Unforgettable. What a woman. I got the right one. And I think she got the right guy too. It was great. That was very, very romantic. Very romantic. Couldn't have asked for anything more.